So like I asked before, like I said, this collection is full of variety. That being said, you have a ton of different mediums that you use. So, and that's kind of different than what we were used to seeing with all your other stuff. So what was it like experiencing with mixed media?
It was really fun. I, throughout schooling, you know, I feel like your teachers want you to get to know the basics, get to know the classics. You know, this is acrylic paint, this is oil paint, you know, the history of them both. And then practicing your art with those mediums first and foremost before incorporating all these different mediums. So now that, you know, I'm done with schooling and there's no one there to tell me, like, you can't mix that, or you can't try that, or that's kitschy. I was really able to kind of come out of my shell and try things that I wanted to try, and there were obviously triumphant fails with things that I tried. Not everything worked out perfectly, and, you know, there were many takes on some of these pieces, especially the mixed media series. But yeah, it was fun. It was a good process and nice to just incorporate something different into my work that made it a little bit more unique than just the oil paint and, you know, these matte acrylic backgrounds that everyone was kind of used to seeing.
So did you feel like experimenting with these different mediums, do you feel like that helped you wash away a boundary that you felt you had when you were painting?
Yeah, I do. It was nice because in my paintings there's lots of figure work, and I think that everybody can agree that there's noticeable figures within my body of work. So it was nice, you know, in this mixed media series, working with photographs. So the figures are there for me, and they're done, they're perfect. So then what I'm really getting to do is use my color sense, use my media sensibility to add to these pictures, make them something else, enhance certain parts and what I enjoy about them, other than me painting an already rendered or depicting, again, a scene that I've already seen.
Awesome. So obviously most people that follow your work know most of your pieces are pretty large in size. So kind of talk about your reasoning behind that and what leads you to keep creating pieces so large in scale.
I think today we live in such a social media, selfie, filtered, loving it, you know, world that when I'm able to paint something on such a big scale, it's so much truth that you're seeing. You're seeing an up-close version of a back or a leg or a chest, whatever part of the body it is. And I think that that adds a little bit of astonishment and just like kind of like a wow factor, you know. You're really, your whole being is, you know, being encompassed by this painting on this scale that is much larger than you. And, you know, when I'm talking about, when I'm painting like a gun or talking about a certain subject that might be political, you know, those are big political issues, you know, big topics. So I think that this scale plays into that. And, you know, if something is maybe like less significant to me or less important, I'm totally open to painting on a smaller scale. And you'll see that a little bit within this collection. Not everything is as big as I've done in the past, but definitely this scale is what I feel like really is pressing an issue or pressing an image or, you know, showing brutal honesty that we don't get to see a lot.
Do you think having pieces so large is something that it takes to grab like millennials' attentions, or does that kind of play into what you're saying about social media? Does the size, you feel like you, that the size helps you kind of take away from that, from people like focusing on that and focusing on, you know, just such classic things as art?
Yeah, I think that it's honestly refreshing when people see things, for example, on my own Instagram, on Raygard, when they're looking through and they're like, I love it, or, you know, leave these comments that are so incredible and so nice, and, you know, or people say, like, not my favorite, or whatever they want to say. It's truly unbelievable to see people's reaction of a picture they'd see on your Instagram, and then when they come into my studio and they see it in real life, there's always this, oh my God, this is so much cooler in real life. This is so much bigger than I imagined. This is this, this is this, and it's 100% of the time more positive. Just because no camera, phone, social media platform is gonna be able to capture the physical experience you have with the painting. So yeah, definitely scale kind of plays with that in the social media game.
Yeah, I can speak to that. Walking in here was definitely a wow factor. So when you have this solo exhibition, when you have your solo exhibition next week, what are you really hoping that people will take away from the collection?
I'm hoping that people will kind of really become in sync, if they haven't already, with me as an artist, and establishing myself as more than just a side project. This isn't just something I'm kind of doing for fun. This is my life. This has changed me, shaped me. This is my livelihood. I dedicate so much of my time and sacrifice, like, friendships, time with family, to be here doing what I'm doing. And I just hope that this body of work, people will have an emotional response to some degree or another, whether it's positive or negative, and feel something in the show. I really do want everybody that comes into that room to have an opinion. Either that wasn't what I was expecting, or that was amazing. You know, if every viewer can have some emotion with something in that room and be able to take away a feeling that they didn't have before, or an inspiration of something that they saw and made them, you know, think about something else, or think on, you know, self-reflection, then I think I've done my job, and that will make me very happy.
Amazing. So people won't really understand the relevance of my next two questions until you completely reveal your collection, but what is your favorite candy?
My favorite candy, I have two, gummy bears and Twizzlers. I'm a sucker
classic.
For Twizzlers. Yeah, two classics.
And then what would be your favorite card game?
Oh, I'm pretty good at gin. Gin's a good one. And if I play poker, I play with candy because I'm not very good at it.
Obviously.
Yeah.
Okay. So something I always like to ask you, just as your friend, I'm always asking you kind of like, what is the hardest piece? What's the piece that's like stressing you out the most? So what in this collection, what do you think's been the most challenging?
The most challenging piece was the large scale gummy bear piece, for sure. It is one of those pieces where a couple years ago, I'll go ahead and admit, if I would have seen that, I would have been like, cool. Like, this artist, like, how can you sell that for that much? You know, like, me being a naive teen or a young 20-year-old, I don't know. I guess I was a teen a couple years ago. No, the gummy bear piece was the hardest because so much thought went into it. I've always wanted to do a candy piece. People who know me, people who don't know me, I love candy. It's great. It just makes everybody happy. Who gets sad from a piece of candy going? So it was definitely the hardest, and there was lots of things that went into it, you know, like, what color is this background going to be? Should it be matte? Should it be glossy? Should it be enamel? Would this look better on a board instead of a canvas? You know, struggling with those questions. And then once it came to the actual candy, getting these bears made, they're not edible, by the way. They're made out of resin. So those color choices and the placement of the gummy bears, I don't think that anybody can imagine how long it took to figure out the way the gummy bears needed to go, which direction they needed to be, and what would be an aesthetically super pleasing and beautiful final product. So that was definitely challenging. And then adhering them all without making the piece too heavy to where the wood structure wouldn't support, you know, you can't have it warping. Mm-hmm. It's like math and science, which I was never good at, turns out to be.
Neither of us.
Yeah, it turns out to be my daily struggle. So that was definitely the most challenging. It was a new experience, but I had fun with it, and I'm glad I did it.
How many hours would you say you put into it?
Oh, God. I really don't know, because... Shoot, sorry. I don't really log my hours or really keep track of time because I'm kind of all over the place when I'm in here. I like have my headphones in, or if my phone's dying, it's like playing music out loud, which I'm sure my neighbors love. And I jump around from piece to piece working on different things, or like, you know.
So you work on pieces simultaneously?
Yeah, for the most part. And especially like with the gummy bear piece. You know, I had to put down that base layer. I had to do it twice because a lazy artist would only do it once. One coat will never cover it properly. Let's just say that. So waiting on that to dry before I could even begin to think about the placement, then rearranging all placements and hearing them. It was a process. I don't know. Multiple hours, maybe like a week's time.
Yeah, that's what I would probably assume.
Yeah.
Okay, so I am personally a huge fan of the theme of this collection, so can you elaborate a little bit more on kind of what it means to you, what you're trying to convey to the audience?
Yeah, so this theme, this show, Fleeting Moments, is truly about finding beauty in life's moments that pass you in a matter of milliseconds and go unrecognized, go unnoticed. And a way that I've found in my art to really capture that is embracing these peaceful moments of that evoke, you know, like nostalgia for a simpler time. We're living in worldly turmoil right now, politically, mental health, you know, like this opioid epidemic. There are so many things going on right now that I think that everybody finds comfort when they think back to a simpler time, you know, retro. Things were black and white, that's how they were. And that's not to say we're not living in the most innovative and greatest time to be alive, but I think that bringing people back to that notion of familiarity and comfort through color and, you know, these like pop art images are really, you know, unifying two subjects that I guess don't really go together. And then another big piece of this puzzle in the collection is speaking on Texas heritage. I'm from Texas, from Houston. So the imagery of guns, horses, cowgirls, bandanas, things like that, you know, big hair, my afros. Those are also true to a Texas person. And Texas is so different from I think that people, there's so much pride in Texas, you know? Everybody knows Texas. So I just think embracing that shared heritage with the people of the Houston community, Texas community, and just, you know, locally and abroad, that those little things of, oh, that's so sweet, or like, that's so Texas, they really shine through. So, I mean, I hope this answered your question.
Yes, yeah, that did, for sure. Okay, so one of my favorite pieces is your self-portrait. I think that it has so much depth behind it, and I kind of want you to talk about like how it came about, your idea behind it. It's just so unique in terms of self-portraits.
Yeah, so the self-portrait came about, you know, every great artist has a self-portrait, and I feel like that is essential to, if you want to be great, which I'm aspiring to be the best, or one of the best. Not, yeah, anyway. You've got to have a self-portrait, and some of my collectors have also voiced that to me, honestly, and said, you've got to do a self-portrait, and I really struggled with that, because what is a self-portrait to me? What does that mean? What am I going to paint of myself that I enjoy, that I'm proud of, and that I want to share with the world? Almost nothing. That, no. So this kind of came to me. I last week went and got my aura read by Carrie Moss. She's a aura reader, a portraiture. She's nomadic. She travels. She was in Houston, and I had this great experience. She took my photograph and read my aura. And so my self-portrait, I've decided, is going to be an atmospheric painting of my aura colors. And I think this is a good way for me to express myself. It's rich with associations of what those colors mean. And another interesting thing is that your aura changes over time. So this self-portrait is something that I want to do for the next 20 years. And I think it'd be really cool to see, like, in the Whitney, or somewhere, you know, in 20 years from now, this collection of self-portraits by this one artist, her lifespan over 20 years. And really what it would be is this like amazing bold room of colors ranging, I mean, I don't even know how much my aura will change by then. 20 years from now, it's hard, I'll be 43. So,
lots of different colors.
Yeah, there's gonna be lots of different colors in there. So I just think that it was when it came to me, I just knew that that was it, and it's a unique way to do a self-portrait instead of me doing some small rendering of myself and then what every year painting myself getting a little bit older, a little more wrinkles. I don't think so.
Yes, I'm very excited about this piece, and I know everyone else is going to be too, and I can't wait to see the ones in years to come. So, typically, a solo exhibition, tell us, what are you sipping on over there?
It's actually green tea. It's from Japan. I'm thirsty. It's a lot of talking.
So, typically, in a solo exhibition, people show about 10 to 20 pieces. Tell us how many pieces you're going to be showing.
Yeah, that is correct. People do show 10 to 20. I'm showing 40. They're not all paintings. There's one sculpture and then three sets of mixed media pieces, and two of those three sets are a series of eight, and the rest are paintings. It truly wasn't my intention to have that many works,
but I just got inspired,
and I was just, you know, in here jumping around, like, my brain was just going off, you know, like, I could only imagine, I don't know, it just happened, it wasn't orchestrated.
Creative explosion.
Yes, I had a creative explosion.
So when you envisioned this collection, I'm kind of like, you just answered this, but all the pieces obviously didn't come to you at once. So did one kind of lead to another? Did one piece inspire the rest? Or how did it kind of happen in your mind?
For sure. So this collection has been in the works for a long time. Long time as in starting the beginning of summer, 2017. I knew what I wanted to paint. I knew what I wanted the series to embody. But, you know, that saying, God laughs when you make plans. Is that the right saying?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, that one. So I orchestrated all of these fantastic paintings, and I was so dead set on them. I was like, this is going to be great. I'm going to knock these out. Like, it'll be perfect. But didn't work out that way. And it really did come from, you know, the one that I started with, which was the pink pony horse painting, and then Urban Cowgirl, which those are the titles of the two pieces. Those are the first two that really started this collection, and you can kind of tell when you see everything together that the colors used in those really stemmed my other choices, and you'll be able to just pick up immediately on this color palette. And yeah, definitely they influence each other, and I'm really happy with the way all the colors have turned out. And yeah,
cool. So I was lucky enough to kind of see like the beginning stages of this collection, you know, like the planning of it, the pictures you took to use as inspiration. So talk a little bit on how you like prepare yourself for a journey of creating a collection of this size.
Ooh, that's a tricky question.
Do you kind of just take things as they come? Do you really like, because I know you personally, like, you really set aside time, blocks of time.
Yeah, I did. I knew that my social life would be sacrificed for this, which was, you know, I accepted it. It's my work. And I, you know, if I'm serious about it, I need to be, you know, willing to make sacrifices. But yeah, I mean, it was hard. I did have to prepare myself, you know, mentally figuring out, like, all my friends are doing this weekend, or like, I have a work event this night. So working around those schedules has been a challenge, and really, I try and get as much work done as I can Monday through Friday. You know, like I wake up around 6 and I'm usually here until around 10:30 every night. So sleep has also been sacrificed. Working out. The simple things in life that you miss.
You put them on the paintings.
Yeah, it's all here on the walls, so.
Okay.
Wait, do you want to stop it?
Yeah, because